seconded by Chairman Dana to approve the agenda. Mr. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Walkup?
Yes.
Chairman Daniel?
Aye.
Chairman? Three ayes, no nays.
Okay. Item number two, we got some transfer requests.
Mr. Chairman, what I've tried to do there, this board met on August the 16th. According to board policy, you had to have 10 days from the very first start of school. That ended on August the 20th. To be fair, for any that came in from the 16th to the 20th, I had added this to the agenda. I have the great esteemed honor and privilege to tell you, I have no transfer, Mr. Powers, to bring to this board, so no action is required on number two. So I thank everybody's, my principals who are here. Hello, Principal of the Year, Cossie, and finalist of the year, Cossie. So, our principals must be doing, Mr. Dean Pitts, Mr. Mitchell, who else is not, anybody else not of our principals? So everybody's doing a good job, but nobody wants to go anywhere. So that's a good news for us.
See if we got Wood in here and Woodbury and Schoenfeld. We're missing Eastside and Auburn and Westside.
But no action was required, Mr. Chairman. You have no transfers. But yeah, I hope everybody's seen the reason I did that. To be fair, for any that would come in after the 16th. So I left the 16th through the 20th. And that was basically the Thursday and Friday and the weekend. And I wanted to make sure that we were doing what we were supposed to do according to the policy. But that's all I have on the transfer, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Item number three, approve the 2018-2019 general purpose budget and possible amendments to reserves. Want to go with that, Mr. Freddie?
I can. I will be proud to do that. Please do that for you, Mr. Chairman. most all of you got the notice in your email, and I will make note. Mr. Sanders has arrived. I will tell you this, that y'all got what I received from Diane, and we saw some information there from the comptroller. In our comptroller's assistant that stated that things had to be done by the first. After consulting with the board attorney and Chuck Cagle and Marianne Dursky and Brian Runyon, all said we could go beyond September and be operating under FY18. And that's what I submitted to you, but after talking to the chairman, And he asked me to go ahead and get in touch with everybody, which I did immediately. I was in a meeting in Cookeville. I pulled out of that meeting and came over and went ahead and did the bidding of the chairman, making sure that this meeting was called for you. But that is, and of course, more things occur through the month of September for the board to delay approving what the commission has approved. Then more things, rough, severe things, start happening in October 1 with the withholding of BEP funding. So the chairman asked to call, and so we are here tonight. And Douglas has looked over the numbers. He's here for you to look over those. He has resolutions also, if you so desire to go that direction. Of course, the commission has called a special call meeting of the commission on Friday at 5. Congruent about on any of the things that we do here, or contingent upon any things that we do here at this body tonight. And the swearing in is on Thursday night at 6 o'clock for Mr. Turney and Mr. Elroy. And then for the new ones, we see some of the new ones here tonight, Mr. Mahaffey and Ms. Davenport and Ms. Floyd. So we welcome the upcoming commissioners to our meeting tonight, as well as the outgoing numbers man, Mr. Glenn Stickley. So we appreciate Glenn being here. But they're going to meet one last time also on Friday at 5. So there is where we stand, Mr. Chairman. And course, we had adopted the 0.75, and the commission is at 68.5. So 0.685 is where the commission is at.
So we're $159,000 apart for teachers.
Roughly, Mr. Chairman. So right now we are operating, Douglas can tell us more about that, we are operating under FY18 currently. And that is usually on the customary things that we do. What's the legal wording there, Douglas, on that?
Normal and customary expenses.
Normal and customary expenses. Well, thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Light up the world here. As you're digesting those numbers a little bit, I will tell you that Ms. Black may iterate a little bit more on this, but we are up in attendance.
How much are we up?
Well, we are right now 1,997 students. That is including pre-K. We are 1,997. I need three more. So if you need three more, we will top 2,000 for the first time in several years.
I
so.
Enrolled one today at 2 o'clock.
Okay, so we are at two more then, right? Do you have to, just
enroll, one.
Just one, okay.
How many is at the high school?
582. So my goal is 6. 600. My goal is 6. Mr. Sanders, we're hoping to achieve that by the time this year is over. So the time we do, but you know how it goes. You get some in and some out, some in and some out. Y'all know very well how we're doing, but that does mean to our number crunchers in the room that we will be having some growth funds. Correct, Douglas? If their ADMs continue where they're at, and we do have some work to do between Skyward and EIS, and Ms. Black is swiftly working on that. Correct, Ms. Black?
Yes, sir.
These are probably a few coding errors and things, but we'll have that corrected rapidly, and the enrollment has already stabilized, but we'll stabilize even more after Labor Day. But I thought I'd give that happy news to you. If these ADMs are up as we think they are, then we will be getting growth money that will assist us in our budget. Will it assist us $159,000, Mr. Chairman? Probably not.
Well, that one she got today, that's $7,000. Where did you come from, Angela?
Virginia.
It's out of state, yes. Virginia, yes.
And I did meet with other directors at our director study council meeting in the Safe and Accountable Schools just the other day, last Thursday, and there are others who are down in the Upper Cumberland. So if I can say we're up 100 or so, I will be more than happy to say that, because some of the others in the Upper Cumberland were down. We were trying to figure out where they had gone, and we had gotten, they'd gone different, I mean, out of states, you know, leaving, not just coming to other counties or going to other places in Tennessee. Many of them had left the state. My friend in Warren County, Bobby Cox, was talking about it, and he was just trying to, did y'all lost to, you know, out of state? I said, no, we're up. And no, I didn't get them from you, so. It was my next words, but.
You'll take them, though.
That's Mr. Chairman. Absolutely. But again, we were looking at the BEP certainly, and ADMs are months 2, 3, 6, and 7. So months 2, 3, 6, and 7. So month 2 will be September, 3 is October, and then February and March. So help out, teachers. Make sure. And we are, Miss Bonnie is not here, but she is working diligently with the new chronic absentee policies, and we're going to see some great partnerships that we've already seen with Judge Melton on that. And we're already looking at some of those who have not been as diligent with attendance in the first few weeks here. And then too, as you deliberate your discussions, we certainly, and we'll be working with the commission too. New board comes on. I would like to continue work on our strategic plan as a board. And you can see y'all's work that you did up on the wall there that we have already worked on in your planning session on the 16th and 17th. And we'll continue to look at that strategic plan and interweave that with our district e plan, which is our school improvement plan and our plan for the district, and weave those two together and meet those goals. And look at our strategic plan and visit that a little bit more, and hopefully have a joint session with the county commission and the new school board coming up at strategic planning that we can do with them. I would hope to do that some point before Thanksgiving, somewhere in the late October time frame. That gives them time to get acclimated in their new jobs and gives us time to get acclimated with two new board members coming on and really look at that strategic plan. But of course, our mission, preparing all students for their future, and in how we're doing that through our vision of that's a new E3 of being engaged in excellence every day. And in our budget should also reflect that we're desiring to increase and to do better. We had some good news there with our test scores, and we want to continue that.
Talking about the improvement scores of TVAS, TVAS.
Right, yeah. And so we're not at the bottom. We are moving up.
TVAS scores, they weren't too we're exciting.
We are moving up. Our third grade scores were exceptional. And I credit that to our Read to Be Ready program that we're doing. Even though your school may not be a Read to Be Ready school, that we're still getting those funds, utilizing that training, and we are doing much better. Third grade scores were up substantially, and Marcia is still not back yet. They were in training today, but Stacy is here. Stacy is one of our instructional coaches and was also being involved with the Read to Be Ready, and third grade across the district, I think, was exceptional. And I think that's because of hard work of what teachers have done. And if we can do it at third, we can do it in all grades. And Principal Nichols was here. I would tell him that same thing at the high school.
What's our options? Do we have any of stay in the course?
The options that this board has is, you know, you can take this budget and you had the yellow budget at 75. You can adapt that down to 68.5. That is an option. You continue to hold your ground, but as we get into September, it can be some ramifications there.
What happens then in September?
Well, you know, it depends who you listen to. I mean, you're going with the FY18 budget is what we will be looking at. So Douglas, no new spending on anything that was other than customary, that your regular and customary charges that you have been doing. So no new things at all on that thing. Just what you have usually been doing that's in that FY18 budget. And I know across the street would love to us to go ahead and move it to 68.5 and live to fight another day. Is what our friends across the street, which you saw that vote that transpired, and Mr. Stick could probably tell you more about that. That 68.5 is what readily passed there with only one abstention and one negative vote against that budget. And their minds were pretty well determined on the 68.5.
I was under the impression, maybe I'm wrong, but the last several meetings, the teachers and principals, you know, that's kind of what we're here for is, you know, we listen to them. That, I mean, that they didn't want to go. I mean, I know they're, you know, they want us to stay where we were at. Am I wrong or no? I mean, I don't. Does anyone want to speak to that? Anybody?
Feeling they wanted 75 cents, didn't they?
Well, I make a motion we stay with the budget we approved last time. The 75?
The yellow one.
Yeah, the yellow one. Sorry,
no, I'm just kidding. Yeah.
Okay, motion been made. Anybody got anything else? The commissioners here want to shed a little light on this. Ms. Maddie, Mr. Stickley. We're talking about four teachers. That's what we're talking about. These are Kim or Donna, the two new ones, right?
Mm-hmm. Ms. Floyd, you mean?
Ms. Floyd.
I'll yield to Glenn first if he wants to make a statement.
Now, my thought on that is that the teachers and the principals are speaking to each other, the aides, the your other faculty, your dietary, your environmental services, or whoever it might be. I would think that you all are talking together, you know, that you guys, when you meet, that you're talking about this stuff. I mean,
I can say as the director that what I have heard is positive at staying at 0.75 by, you know, most of the people that I've talked to in my visits in the schools, that they appreciate the board stand at 0.75.
I had no intentions, if I may speak. I had no intentions of saying anything because I've said enough over the last several months, and I've shared data statistics with my fellow commissioners and also with Mr. Chairman and Mr. Director here. But the 68.5 cents meets BEP and it meets MOE. So that is what the school board deserves as far as the money we have coming in. Anything else would be up and beyond, and I think we all know, or I know all the commissioners know, that Cannon County Commission has been overfunding the school system for several years now, and that overfunding has gotten us what we're talking about now, a loss of 184 students in 6 years. Last year, expenditures for 17-18 was $1,060,000 more than it was 16-17. 43 more students lost last year and lower rankings. So So is additional money the problem, I guess is the question. All the statistics that you look at, that's.
Well, I'm no expert at all, but if you're basing the budget, the county, the crisis that they're in, off of what you just said on our loss of students in the last 6 years or the last year, I just can't see. I don't know where all the cuts have been made in other departments or areas, but I don't feel like this is one that needs to be cut. I mean, we've made adjustments, haven't we? I mean, have we or not? Have we made, I mean, we've tried to move things around or work in areas that we can, but
Do you know the cumulative amount of how much y'all overfunded us over the years?
I don't have that with me right now.
Because the only thing that sticks with me is that $1 million. I mean, how much of a hole would y'all be in if y'all hadn't borrowed from the school debt service? And I should have done my research, but that $250,000 we were paying the commission a year, does any other county do that? Pay the commissioners so that they issue a bond so that we have a school? Usually they just issue bonds to build the school and go from there. I mean, y'all correct me if I'm wrong. I know other places have more money to do that, like Rutherford. They'll build a school a year. Yeah. But do they have the school board pay them money from their BEP?
That $250,000 was y'all's money anyway. We should have never had it.
Never. That's the only sticking point.
I don't understand. Everybody says they know that we weren't supposed to be doing that, but why did we continue to do that?
And that there's supposed to be a plan to get that $1 million back, but that's the certain things that the state, I know they don't like uncertainty, but they sure don't help us with direction. You know what I'm saying?
You're right. They don't. They're just quick to point out anything they think you're doing wrong.
That's right. And we're a team, the commission and school board. I appreciate y'all's work. And there's two ways to look at it. You got the new guys coming on. Mr. Elrod, Mr. Turney there, and you hate to dump that in their lap, but from my talking to Mr. Turney, he's ready to pick up the fight too. So, you knew I.
That's what we call fight. Let's call it a job.
A job. That's right. That's true. Because I don't want to be a hypocrite. Because I initially voted for a lesser budget, but once I saw y'all come back and we're being that so close apart. I started supporting the team. I guess I'm a, what do you call when you jump on lately? Johnny come lately?
I am all for the students in Cannon County getting the best education that we can possibly give them. To the point where I've looked and seen how much needs to go in the classroom. Several people have heard me talk about dollars into the classroom. Some states have adopted 62%, some have adopted 65%. Right now, as of last year, 58% went into the classroom according to the categories that the Federal Board of Education requires in that. And I personally would like to see more go into classroom because it's for the kids and we need to pay the teachers more. Well, do it. From the numbers I've seen, we're all looking at the same numbers. It's just a different perspective about it. I think from what I've seen and everything I've checked, and I'm totally independent on this. I don't have any children in schools. I don't have any people with the Board of Education. I love everybody here. But from what I see, I honestly think that the school board has the money. They just need to take a look at where they're spending it. Mm-hmm. And I won't go into all the reasons. We can do that some other time if you'd like. I'd be happy to talk about that. But I put the money where it'd do the most good, and that's in the classroom.
You spoke that we was losing students those years. We're already 150 students up over last year. It was 1848, is that what I'm?
1849, yes, sir, was the AEM.
Your enrollment last year included pre-K, something like 1943, is that correct?
It would be.
So 1943 versus 1997?
What happens if we have undecided budgets?
Well, that's a good question, Mr. Pitts. I've talked to other directors, and most all the other directors that I talked to, the other at the Upper Cumberland, all of them have budgets. Basically, what they had last year is what they received from, you know, all these districts. I don't think none of them are at the impasse that we are, or the situation that we are in right now in the Upper Cumberland. Now, I did talk to a friend in Dixon County. Dixon County has, you know, was on the news previously several years ago. Clay County, I've not saw the director at Clay County. He's not been the last two. The guy I know that they had they shut down schools, I think, in October a few years back because they were still not agreeing at that late date. And they ended up shutting schools down for a week. But you know, we have time to see if we can come to some agreement of that. But again, October 1 is when we will receive cutoff of BEP funding from the state if the budget has not been approved. October 1. Now, in the meantime, you hear varying ones. I've heard different ones from the comptroller. Y'all saw those emails that stated about that, and I re-verified and talked with Diane in regard to that, and so the person that stated that was probably not stating the exact facts that were given. That's where I reached out to Marion Dursky and also to Brian. And Brian, if we have emails we received, correct Douglas, that we operate off FY18. So Mr. Pitts, to answer your question, that's what happens. We still continue to talk and see if we can come to an agreement. I think part of the problem is that if the commission raises any more, Mr. Steakley, is that correct? Then that's considered an increase. Is that correct, Mr. Mahaffey? That if we say 70, even if y'all wanted to go to 71 or 72 or somewhere in the middle there, you would still have to have a public hearing on that, and then that would have to be voted on by the commission to increase from 68.5 up to 70 or whatever the compromise would be.
Increase then.
And that would be still considered an increase according to the fiscal agents. Mm-hmm. That would be considered an increase, and thus being the increase, there's where you would have the difficulty because you'd have to do a public hearing. So that's it'd have to be a referendum. That's incorrect. It's a public hearing in front of the commission, and the pros and cons of their side, the county commission side is saying to us, you're considering this a tax increase, even though we were 10 cents below what we received last time because of the reappraisal, that because of those reappraisals, a penny is bringing in more money, about what does this $4,000 more per penny, and so that's where they said we're going to give you the bare minimum, and I think that's what hurt when a commissioner looked at me and said, "And we're going to give you the bare minimum. That's it." Like he doesn't want the schools to receive any more than, and that was one person talking to. I understand that, but when the commission voted, then to, you know, and except for one individual and one abstention, when they voted that's when I said, okay, I knew then. And some of the crowd wanted to dispute that. I said, nope, it's already, I don't want to use the phrase done deal, but it was pretty well apparent by the commission the way they wanted to say it because of the deal with the comptroller's office of being fiscally, what's the word I'm looking for, Glenn? Physically solvent is the word, I guess. Like, is that too strict of a word?
I wouldn't say so.
That it would have to be physically secure in what they're, because they are under the gun across the street. It's really under the gun, under the comptroller. I've heard that statement many times, Ronnie, a bunch. But I've heard that y'all are under the gun.
From his heel.
Okay. I try to be tactful here, please. We have members of the press, so I'm trying to be very tactful here. But I'm just saying that y'all are really under, the commission is really under the gun because of everything.
We're just trying to make better decisions.
And I sat there the other night, and this may be relevant or not be relevant, but when I sat there the other day, and I seen the struggle that y'all had to say, had to choose between a new ambulance and a fire engine. You know it's tough when they have to make a choice between a fire engine and an ambulance. You know you're in deep trouble when a commission has to make that kind of decision. A Solomon-like decision is what I would describe that to be. Kevin, you can quote me on that. So,
they want to give us 2 more cents. How would that affect the county budget? or is that an impossibility to give students 2 more cents?
Right now, it's impossible because the commission has already approved the 6.5%. It'd have to go back to the negotiating table, and it'll have to be with the new commissioners.
So, how would that affect the county if they wanted to give 2 more cents? What else would have cut something somewhere else, I guess?
Yes.
The budget committees, how many meetings, Ronnie, have y'all?
18.
Y'all 18 meetings?
18 meetings.
That they've worked since January? March? You thought we had a tough schedule, guys. You know, they've met 18 times to iron this stuff out.
How many teachers do we have?
170.
Yeah.
And what about other?
We've got some, Marsha's not here right now, but that's about 170 something right there. It depends on
teachers.
164 is what I always try to go by.
And then what about the other staff employees? How many do we have?
It's over 400 total.
Yeah, 400 total staff in everything. You start seeing subs and all of those that we deal with all the time. We are the largest employer in Cannon County.
So we have, we'll say 2,000 students and then 400.
And I might add, get most of the tax dollars.
Yes.
Yep.
56% of all the money that comes into County County goes to the school system. That's over half.
That's pretty well by law.
To other counties.
Right. Yeah, that's pretty well by law, by state statute, that you're having to do that.
Can I ask a question? Yeah. 56% based on the property tax.
All money.
County County budget is well over $30 million operation. School board, 17 million. Last year.
That's all from the state.
No, that's all federal. That's all money.
I know, but that money came from the state, earmarked for the schools, so you couldn't spend it anyplace else. So it wasn't like it was given to the schools.
Like you were forced out of your...
Yeah.
And I think if the county contributes, what, right at $2 million? That's what the county puts in.
So, are there 17 million?
2.6. It's one of the lakes. I mean, it goes a long way, you know.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Happy, Mr. Happy.
Yes.
If y'all would permit, and Tim, to address some of your comments, which again, I'll just say amen or second to everything that Glenn has stated. You know, education is the number one priority it should be in this county because it's the future of this county. Mm-hmm. And I speak as a citizen. I'm not a commissioner yet. Did work on the budget committee, but I'm here as a citizen trying to learn to be better informed when I become a commissioner, to try to do the very best I can for the citizens of this county. I represent the 5th district, but I represent all citizens of this county. We can't undo the past. Y'all are aware of, commissioners are aware of, anyone that's paid any attention at all, the articles in the paper and so on and so forth, know the financial situation that the county is in, other than the educational system. So since you can't change the plan, all you do is draw the line in the sand and go forward. You can't change the past. So in looking and trying to be absolutely fair as we could and bridge the gap to get us a fiscal year further down the road, and as Glenn's already alluded to, trying to build a reserve working toward a reserve was a $1 million minimum based on where we're at today. Probably the comptroller would say it should be a more closer to $1.4 million. But the plan that was submitted to the comptroller's office, signed by the commissioners, was to build up $1 million reserve. And up until this fiscal year just ended, really there had been no, almost minimal to, might as well say very little success had been achieved in that arena. A little, but nothing to speak of. Wasn't on target. Got a little bit of a windfall in a couple of areas. Basically, one department turned in money, a little over $200,000. That was really a windfall back in the hoppers. Of course, we're at this point right now, we're borrowing money to pay bills because we don't have the cash flow to pay the bills. And that'll continue until early part of January before we really get tax revenues in and have money in the accounts to pay the bills. As long as that's going on, the comptroller, it probably is not going to cut us much slack, just a fact, and I don't blame him for that. But in trying to meet our obligations to y'all, in trying to be fair to y'all, of course the state has guidelines with you, ADMs and MOEs, similar, and the DEP, of giving guidelines to be met financially, obligation that we need to meet. Of course, that's being done, being double-checked, rechecked. In fact, it's a little bit over that, nothing to talk about, so I'll just say we're meeting the minimum requirement. But last year, the commissioners did vote and stopped the $250,000 being required to pay back, or not pay back, contribution, I'll call it. So that was, I'll use the term windfall, maybe that's too harsh, maybe that's not the right word, but at least you kept $250,000 in your hoppers that you were not keeping. In that, by mistake, and it was a mistake, what the commissioners actually voted for last fiscal year was y'all to receive 84 cents. Somehow on the budget that went to the comptroller's office, 85 cents was put in. So you got a cent that was not voted on to be received, but since it had been submitted and signed off on, you got an extra $20,000 thrown in your hopper that was not to be in there. And checking the numbers as of 6:30 of this year, and Douglas was kind enough to identify, we had budgeted in the budget of the property tax producing $1,728,475. Actually, and this was not an exact figure that Douglas gave, but it was close enough to a final to say, okay, you got $1,799,176.12. That's $70,701 more in the hopper. So money's $250,000, $70,000, an extra $20,000. That adds up in y'all's, accounts to help the cause. So providing the 68 and a half cents, folks, it's a fair shake for y'all in this coming fiscal year. Just my perspective. My read on the numbers, just approaching it from a person that's sitting there looking at the numbers that are there and trying to be fair to y'all and to the citizens of this county. And I appreciate y'all. I appreciate you going to battle for it because that's what you're in position to do. I would expect no less, the pushback. But there comes a time, as Mr. Curtis made the statement, and I would agree with it. And again, just Ron had his opinion. You know what opinions are worth. And I appreciate that. Y'all do with it what you want. But you know, you save your fight for another day. That, maybe the odds are there and it's something to be really to go to bat for in the sense of saying it's a necessity to make it work the way it needs to work for the students of this county. Maybe I'm wrong with that assumption in my of conclusion of where I've drawn off the data and observed and seen, trying to, again, balance an act of where we're at from the commissioner's side and balance an act of where y'all at from your school board side. So that's just Ron Mahathis' opinion.
Well, I know you said we can't change the past, but I do want to know, you said the $250,000 you all stopped from the payment of that. How long have you been paying that?
So
2 years, 2 years, 3 years.
No.
Whenever the schools were created, what year?
2001, 2001, yes, sir.
All right, so we've been
paying that. It's going in the same account. At that time, no one knew any different to do. It just came to light last year, I believe.
Well.
And as soon as we found out about it, we corrected it.
Now, this is the 250 that was part of the deal. If you build us an annex and a new school, we'll put in $250,000 a year, which agreement the state should never pass, I mean, allowed.
And so, and you said the commissioners stopped that last year, I think is what you said, and I want to know how long we've been paying that, and under the same commissioners, how long have we been paying that under the same commissioners? You don't know?
I don't have that information.
And what made you all decide that we didn't have to pay that back?
Because we checked legally, and we should not have. From what is my understanding, that should have not been done to start with, so we need to correct it.
And it went on for how long?
Since 2001, 2002.
16 years, that's $4 million.
Yeah.
You do that with a calculator.
And what made you all look into that? I mean, who, what was?
It was an audit finding.
Had to do with an audit finding, yes.
And it wasn't, it was.
Why wasn't the auditors was catching before that, so.
But why was it in a different line item? Where was it going that they didn't see that anywhere?
I don't have all that information with me. You might want to check with the controller.
I mean, that's $4 million that, I think somebody mentioned we were getting what we deserved, but, I mean, we were giving far more to, I don't know what. I mean, and that was more, the school system needed that, and where it went, we don't know now, because, I mean, we can't buy an ambulance or a fire truck, or, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not saying it's anybody's fault.
It went to pay off the debt.
It was in debt service.
Yeah, it was left pocket, right pocket, yes, type deal. It wasn't just money.
It wasn't money that the county commissioner spent.
Yeah.
But didn't go into the debt of schools, right?
Yeah.
Well, it would have been paid off earlier.
No, it did. No, it did go for debt for schools.
It wouldn't have paid them off any earlier.
It went in debt service, that's all. And I wasn't a commissioner, but I feel confident on that part of that. Yeah, it was the left-hand pocket versus the right-hand pocket.
You're right. Y'all have been borrowing off of debt service is what you've been doing. Out of that debt service is what.
But we always had to pay it back.
Yeah, that always had to.
We've got none of the money.
So, what, let me see if I see this deal right. For 4 teachers apart. And you're telling us 68.5 cents, and that's the 75, it's 4 teachers. Wanting us to do that, then you want us to scotch you and let the bar against the debt service. Now, how's that work? I mean, we're gonna scotch y'all. That's what's gonna happen. They said over there, we're gonna have to bar against that debt service. We're scotching you. But you wanna cut our legs out over four teachers.
Anything the commission bars, they have to pay back for.
I understand that. I think if I pull that out there, that I didn't get it today, but.
Mr. Chairman, may I say something else?
Yes, sir.
As well, didn't want to get into this, but, I mean, if we're gonna look at everything, look at 40 teachers that are on the payroll in Cannon County that the state of Tennessee says that we shouldn't have. 40 teachers, too many.
Well,
I don't think that's what it's saying. I think there's a huge misunderstanding.
The BEP on that, the BEP is just that, the formula for the basic things that the state says they're going to pay for.
Salaries and benefits on that is $1.6 to $1.8 million.
Whereas, on BEP, what that is a formula as for the basic things that the state said they will pay. They're expecting the county to go on and pay that difference between that, as the local contribution to education. So, you know, I've been in talks with Senator Foti, and also Representative Boyle will be with me on Thursday again. And my deal is going to continue to raise the BEP. continuing to fully, you know, to fund it even more. And friends of the legislature have said the same thing. But when you look at the BEP, that is, when we say we're 40 teachers over, that's what the state says we're going to pay for here. And when you say you don't want to pay any more than that, what you're saying is that we don't want to give anything for education in this county. The county doesn't want to give anything into education, is what you're saying. When you're saying if you just want the 40, to, you know, the 40, but we're 40 over, that's what you're saying to the citizens of this county is that we don't want to pay anything for education. And so that's the difference between the BEP and the BEP figures there are just that. That's what the bare minimum says. But still, and the state says that we're going to give you, let's give you an example of 80%, and the county has to come up with the 20% on all teachers. So they're saying, what the state is saying, and I don't think anybody is fully operational by the state or state takeover. We local folks like to run our own schools. You know, we're all for that, and that's where we're going to contribute more. So when I look at these figures from the July final one and see this is what the state says we're going to give you is our part. Not that that's going to be the only part. We're not a York Institute. They get 100% state funding. They're saying to us that Canyon Countyans need to have a voice in their schools, and the voice that you have in your schools is the percentage between what the county says they're going to give and the BEP. And that's federalism. I mean, government has to come off. That's where it's federalism in action, where you've got the federal providing so much, the state providing so much, and the local providing so much. And so the BEP is saying, this is we're going to give the schools, that the counties, excuse me, have funding for our own schools. So there's my soapbox tonight. As the government teacher.
Can I ask just a simple, I'm really new at this, and I just have a simple question to ask. Okay, it was said we got $17 million last year. 15 came from the BEP. That 68 cents, or that figure you're being quoted, Mr. Steakley, is all the money that's come into the county. Well, if 15 million that come into the county was ours anyway, what part is the county given to the BEP money, to the schools?
We can
about 2 million.
Okay, 2 million. What part is that? What percent is that of the taxes that we're getting on property?
A little over 20%.
So actually, the county's only giving us 20% of the tax money, and every time anybody mentions the school getting a raise, they start going ballistic that we're causing the taxes to get raised. But that don't seem real realistic to me. Does that make sense? Or I'm too being too simplistic?
No, I'm not gonna argue with you. No.
Well, I'm like I said, I'm a taxpayer, and this is what I've found out, that it's not my schools that's causing my taxes to go up so much.
Ms. Floyd, do you have a question?
I just have to disagree with you, Freddie. That I don't think that people are saying that they're not for education when they're asking those types of questions at all.
Right, no, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that when that commissioner tells me we're going to give you the bare minimum is all we're going to give you.
You know, the city.
And that's one man's.
So that's that. I just have to say that that's a big disagreement I have right there with that statement. The second thing is, since I'm new, I do want to have a little bit of an understanding of the numbers that we're having at each of the schools. If you please tell me the numbers that you have at each of the schools and the capacity, please, for each school.
I do not have the, I can go get the totals for the classrooms in each school, but I do not have.
We'll be glad to get that for you.
What the okay. capacity of the buildings are.
We'll be glad to get that for you.
Okay.
You need that tonight before you leave.
No, I just think that would be, because I think that would be helpful in just understanding these types of numbers that Glenn was bringing up when we're hearing that there's 40 excessive teachers that are going, you know.
Well, that's a formula.
I know, for the BEP, and the BEP right. is different
the BEP
than the maintenance
take
of effort.
In consideration of the logistics of the county and where schools are versus where children
and
live.
And BEP comes from the state, and the maintenance of effort is what we're required.
Right.
So I'm getting my arms all around all of this, so. But I do want to have those numbers, please. Thank you.
And I hate to beat a dead horse, but I mean, that 250 that was never should have been coming from our money. If it wouldn't have come from us, where would it have come from to pay that debt off? See what I'm saying? Where would it have come from?
Taxes.
Okay. The county commission, that's right.
Kim, you got anything?
I do not.
Mr. Attorney, you can speak. I guess you got the board. Would you get a citizen?
I believe that Mr. Power spoke for me, and I'm going to back him up and say that he did. We did speak, and I think that most of the principals and the employees that I've talked to, I think all have general consensus that what the board has agreed on is what we want to stand for. And if I was in his spot, then that's what I would stick with. And I believe that, you know, you took that position to speak for them, and I believe that's the consensus that I'm getting, and I wouldn't budge with it, period. And we can psychoanalyze what needs to be done as a bare minimum, but I don't know about you, but sometimes the bare minimum is not cutting. And I have to go above and beyond my job every day. And so if we're going to operate on what we minimally have to do, sometimes you have to do more. And I'm speaking for everybody out there. And if we have a principal or an employee in here that has a different idea on what I'm saying here, speak up. But I feel that's what I'm being told here.
It
bothers me to think about education and say bare minimum, because when I see those children every day, I can't pick out which one of them I think needs to be bare minimum. When I see all the 400 and something kids I have in my school, they're all my kids, and I want them all to have the very best education possible. And the bare minimum just it just does something. If you run a bare minimum system, you're going to get a bare minimum education, and a bare minimum future, and you can push that concept on and so forth. And I think anyone in here that's employed, does your employer expect you to do the bare minimum? Now above the bare minimum, that is the question. But I personally expect my employees to do what it takes. And we rarely do the bare minimum. So.
I think we've talked a lot too in our last several meetings about the need for the kids, and I mean even our teachers and staff, for the need for guidance counselors and what these kids are going through and what our teachers have to do to help those kids go through those things. And if we keep taking away from that, we're losing an opportunity to bring somebody in here and help our students and help our teachers or whoever. We just keep taking away, and we're not ever going to be able to grow and build on that. So, and I think about that a lot. Mr. Meacham's talking about, I can't pick a kid who's the bare minimum. Who am I going to allow to be the bare minimum kid here? And there's not one kid who fits that should have to hear that. Not one, not our, nobody in the system. Nobody.
Well, you mentioned bare minimum. I just asked the question. The budget last year, where did it fall? Plenty of the county versus your budget. Where did it fall last year?
Could you be a little more specific?
As far as the amount of funding versus bare minimum, where did it fall last year?
How much over?
Yeah.
Go ahead and tell us, how much was it?
$66,149. Well, it was 20,000 more because of the 1 cent, that's correct.
Yeah.
So again, this year isn't out of line, is what I'm trying to tell you folks.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is me and the people that I talk with, I am not willing to go any less than that, because I think that we're taking away when you say that. And I understand you're saying we're not, I get that. But I have 5 kids, I have nieces and nephews, I have good friends in this school system, I have teachers in this school system that are friends of mine, and I don't know how else to say it, and I'm the least knowledgeable person about any of this, but I do know that we keep going. I mean, is it going to be 50 cents the next time we come back in here? I don't know. I mean, but if we give and give and give, where are we going to be? I don't know.
We give every year?
Yeah.
Since I've been here.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. If we keep...
Read the motion there, Mr. Freddie.
Mr. Chairman, a motion was made by Ms. Walker, no second as of now, to have the 2018-2019 general purpose school budget to stay at 0.75 cents.
I second the motion. Call the roll.
Mr. Powers.
Aye.
Mr. Sanders.
Aye.
Ms. Walker.
Yes.
Chairman Dan.
Aye.
Chairman Daniel, 4 ayes, no nays. Motion carries.
Okay. Any other business we need to look at while we're here?
That is all. Of course, the next board meeting will come up with the workshop is September the 11th. I would like some guidance on that for a moment. I'm going to be at the state superintendent's fall conference is in Gatlinburg. And I'm asking if perhaps Dr. Melton could be in my stead while I'm finishing that conference. That's on Wednesday. We finish up Wednesday at noon. So if I could beg your absence for that workshop and have Dr. Melton act in my stead till I return on the Wednesday. So what's your guidance there, Mr. Chairman?
Do we need to make that in the motion?
We don't.
I'd
just
say she
says she will be your advisor during that time.
Or if I know
what you're going on. I am. I have. That's contingent on.